And God called the dry land earth, and the gathering together of the waters he called seas. And God saw that it was good. And God said, Let the earth bring forth grass, the herb yielding seed, and the fruit tree yielding fruit after his kind, whose seed is in itself upon the earth. And it was so. And the earth brought forth grass, and herb yielding seed after his kind, and the tree yielding fruit, whose seed was in itself after his kind. And God saw that it was good. Genesis, the beginning of time. Some think we have reached the end.
People need to understand that the public lands of the United States are, of course, something that belongs to all Americans. And the national forest system consists of 191 million acres of these lands. We take people on our trips who are educated, urban people, well-read. Most of them have college educations. And they're shocked to find out that logging is even allowed in the national forests because they look at their Rand McNally atlases and they see all those green national forests in Wyoming and Utah and Montana and Idaho, and they think those lands are protected. Well, of course they're not. In 1964, Congress passed a law called the Wilderness Act, Public Law 88577, and it was signed into law by Lyndon Johnson on September 3rd of that year. And the Wilderness Act was the first time in the history of this country that we had a legislative way of saying that certain areas are completely off limits to the type of development that you're seeing here. Livestock grazing and some other uses that I feel are basically incompatible with the concept of wilderness were grandfathered in order to get the act passed when the Wilderness Act was passed. You know, we're standing within one of the great remaining ecosystems in the United States. The Bob Marshall Wilderness is about 2.4 million acres of roadless country, one of the largest chunks of real wilderness remaining in the 48 states. In fact, one thing that's unique about the Bob Marshall is it not only has a healthy population of grizzlies, it's the only place where grizzlies still come down to the prairies on the east side. But, you know, with the exception of the bison, virtually every species indigenous to the area that was there when the continent was settled by white people is still there in at least some numbers in the Bob Marshall Wilderness Complex. And what we need to be looking at is a visionary wilderness system where wilderness is not simply an area to recreate in. It's not simply a place for backpacking or horsepacking or biking or cross-country skiing. You know, we've got to get away from the user group, it's a piece of pie to dole out type of mentality and begin looking at wilderness as the only chance for evolution to continue to occur. The only chance to preserve species that can't survive anywhere else. The only chance, you know, to have a segment of the earth still functioning as it has for millennia and millennia. Ah.
The destruction of the Brazilian rainforest attracted worldwide attention. International concern about global warming and other environmental side effects reached a new high. What relatively few Americans realized was that the same practices occurring in Brazil with respect to the rainforest were occurring within the borders of the United States.
As I said before, we've lost to logging destruction 95% of the nation's forests. And for comparison, Brazil has only lost 15% of theirs. Japan has only lost a third of theirs. Japan still has 27% of its area, entire country's area, covered with virgin native forests. If we stopped logging ours today, we would have less than 2%.
It's amazing that most people aren't even aware that national forests are logged, much less that they're logged to the extreme extent that they're being logged. And so one of the really important things that I do and other environmental groups is that it's bringing that awareness to the public, because that's what's going to make things change. The public is really being duped in terms of them not knowing what's happening on the national forest. They think their national forests are being protected, and they're not. They're being overlogged and overmined and overgrazed. And it's getting to the point where these ecosystems are beginning to unravel. In the Northwest, we have a case where the northern spotted owl has recently been listed, which means it's becoming threatened and endangered. The reason it's being listed is because of the overcutting on private and particularly federal lands. When a species is listed, it means that in the case of the spotted owl, it's an indicator species. It's like the canary in the mine shaft. It's at the top of a pyramid of a complex web of life. And when that top of the pyramid is starting to show signs of being endangered or going extinct, it means that whole ecosystem is in trouble. And that's what's happening across the United States to many ecosystems, is that they're starting to unravel. And what that means is that that's the basis for our life. That's the basis for clean water. It's the basis for clean air. It's just a lot of important things that are represented by these ecosystems.
The Northwest's rainforest were once dominated by trees up to 2,000 years old. Huge, healthy, Douglas fir, cedar, spruce. Today, only about 5% of virgin old-growth forest remains.
15 years from now, we won't be cutting any ancient forest groves in Oregon and Washington. Everything that's left will either have been protected in parks and other preserves and wilderness areas, or it will have been cut. That's where we'll be 15 years from now. We'll be in a second growth timber economy, cutting all smaller logs, trees, in computerized mills, with 30 or 40% fewer workers in those two states in the timber industry. That's inevitable. The only question is, when we get there, will we have any ancient forests left, or will we have finished them all off?
I'm from back east. I've always lived on the East Coast, and I live in Connecticut now. I live in a 1800s farmhouse, and we have two or three trees on our property that are about 200 years old, and they're in a book about famous trees in our area. And I never really looked at the trees until I saw the book. And then I looked around, and my friend Bill began to talk to me about what's going on out here, and I suddenly realized that all the woods near my house, there are no old trees. And I realized why. They were all cut. And we can't let that happen out here.
I mean, when the first forester got on the stand, he said years ago, what we'd do was we'd cut one spot and then we'd move down the road and pick another one to keep people working.
We're taking our American heritage and, you know, we're just putting it right down the drain. I'm not going to be able to show my kids, and not to speak about their kids and the next 10 generations down the road, any of this, you know, that is so incredibly renowned throughout the world.
The timber industry would like to say, well, forests are a renewable resource, and in some settings they are. But ancient forests are not a renewable resource, at least not in the lifetimes of our grandchildren's grandchildren. It may be that in a couple of thousand years we can recreate some of those forests. We don't know whether that's true or not. What we do know is that the ancient forest of the Pacific Northwest is a life system. And it's just like the body. I mean, at a certain point, you damage the life support system enough that the body dies. And we are certainly going to be left with a few fragments of forest, whatever policy we adopt. The question is whether we've hurt the life support system, the network of the forest, so much that the patient will have died and you won't have a system.
The destruction of the old growth forest has been the direct result of clear cutting.
What we mean by clear cutting is they just come in and cut all the trees in a given area, all of them. And they take what trees aren't big enough, what's not representative of enough profit for them, and they leave that there and they burn it to sort of simulate a natural disaster. So the theory being that the forest will regenerate itself.
Say, be careful with fire in the forest. Just like Smokey says, only you can prevent forest fires.
Well, it turns out that the Forest Service has become a very bloated and big bureaucracy solely devoted to the production of timber for the timber industry. And that's how it is, because they all have jobs, and the first order of business for a bureaucracy is to perpetuate itself, or to grow, or to increase its budgets every year, or to increase all the people's salaries who work there. Well, I thought of Smokey the Bear, and good stewardship was their job, and we found out to our regret that it's not so.
Most people think our national forests are just like our national parks. They're protected. But in fact, the national forests are managed primarily by the U.S. Forest Service for logging, clear cutting, and creating tree farms rather than native forests. Traditionally, most people have considered Smokey the Bear to be their friend. But they don't realize that Smokey is out there guarding the forests, keeping that timber dry so that the Forest Service and the timber company can cut it right on schedule next year and the year after and the year after that, and turn it into clear cuts and eventually to managed forests, which are not that attractive for recreation and not as important for wildlife.
The Forest Service is an agency of the United States Department of Agriculture. It was formed pursuant to the Agricultural Appropriation Act of 1906. Its mandate was the conservation and best use of public forest land. In recent years, the policy of the United States Forest Service has been to maximize the commercial use of public forest land. That means clear cutting, exportation, and road building.
So the role of the Forest Service in administering the public lands that were designated as national forests is to try to meet the needs of the people in the national forests. And part of the founding creed of the Forest Service was to try to provide the greatest good for the greatest number in the long run, which is a mouthful.
A major challenge, I guess, for an agency like the Forest Service is to try to be responsive to public concerns. And our job is to manage national forests in the public interest. And so, of course, the challenge then is how do you meet the public interest, because there's a whole variety of publics.
The Forest Service road construction program is proceeding at a rate of about 8,000 or 9,000 miles per year. And the agency plans to at least double the road mileage. As the Forest Service builds more roads, as they clear cut more like they did on that 45-degree slope behind me, as they reduce our native, evolving, diverse forests to simple tree farms, with not much more biological diversity than a field of corn. We're losing a heritage. We're losing a portion of our planet's ability to sustain life, and that's really what it's all about.
We have been cutting timber in this valley for the last 41 years, and we don't feel that we have harmed the valley, and as a proof of that, we have people coming to this valley all the time who think this is just beautiful, and yet timber activity has taken place here for the last 100 years. Matter of fact, the first Forest Service sale that ever took place in the United States took place in this valley back in 1892. It was a 50 million foot timber sale. So we've been cutting timber off these hills for the last 100 years, and quite frankly, it doesn't look bad to me. I think we're doing a fine job of regeneration, and even though years ago they didn't really concern themselves with regeneration, the area seems to be looking after itself.
In order to call attention to this national situation, the Alliance for the Wild Rockies, a grassroots coalition, organized a 200-mile bike adventure across Montana's Flathead National Forest.
One of the things that we were wanting to accomplish, and I think we are accomplishing with the Ride Through an American Forest, is to bring people together from diverse backgrounds, from around different parts of the United States, and give them a fact-finding tour of what's actually happening out on our public lands, our national forest lands, federal lands which belong equally to all Americans, regardless of whether they live in Montana or Florida.
The group's organizers, Mike Bader and Bill Curry, assembled a diverse group of bikers for the trip.
I realized it was a national issue. It was going to take American people to stop this because Washington makes the decisions. My friend John Oates, he's the godfather of my son. I've been telling him about this for a long time. I thought a concert like Sting did for the Brazilian rainforest we could do for the American forest. And he called me one day and says, I have an idea. He said, let's do a bike trip through the national forest.
John Oates, one half of the very successful musical duo Hall and Oates, and Bob Weir of the enormously popular group The Grateful Dead, were key participants in this monumental undertaking.
Then there are other places where
Gary Fisher, sportsman and creator of the mountain bike, Howie Wolk, author and dedicated environmental activist, Jeff DeBonis, founder of Forest Service Employees for Environmental Ethics, as well as other environmental leaders, rounded out the roster for this incredible trek.
A Ride Through an American Forest, statement of purpose. The purpose of the Ride Through an American Forest is to focus national attention on the desecration of natural forest ecosystems, our American heritage. America's forests give us cold, clear water to drink. They regulate global and regional climates. Natural forests provide habitat for fish and wildlife. Yet the cumulative impacts of clear-cutting and road-building on private and state and federal public lands are industrializing America's native forests, destroying the rich biological diversity of plant and animal species that thrives there. Right on.
The point of the ride was to bring public attention to certain key points regarding our national forests. First, that each year, the United States destroys more of its own rainforest than does Brazil in the Amazon. Approximately one out of every four logs cut in the United States are exported to Japan. Our national forest ecosystems are fragmented by 358,000 miles of logging roads, nearly 10 times the mileage of the entire interstate highway system. Indeed, there are enough logging roads to stretch to the moon and back. The United States taxpayers, you and I, have been subsidizing this wholesale clear-cutting of ancient trees. We have been doing it for years and will continue to do so unless it is stopped. Less than 1% of our original native forests are protected. Almost all the remaining groves are scheduled for elimination under current U.S. Forest Service and Bureau of Land Management plans.
These roads allow the lumber industry to come into these areas, cut the trees, and make a profit. You do not make any money on this profit. It costs you money to build the roads. The lumber industry makes the profit.
These people, the timber industry and the Forest Service people, are very, very good at manipulating politicians. And they're also very good at keeping this quiet. But they are raping our land. This is our land. We are paying for this.
It'll go back and forth if it's loose enough.
Yeah. It's a little on the right side.
Really? That's how you tell, huh?
If you ride this bike on.
Fly that baby.
They've dropped at you.
Yeah,
when I was a kid.
That's great.
So the journey along the narrow, rocky logging roads began. Many of the bikers were unprepared for what they found along the way. Legacy!
at the end of our 175-mile mountain bike ride through Swan Valley in Montana. It's been a very inspiring trip, and it's also been a very depressing trip, because I've seen things here that have really outraged me and have really made me sad about the state of our country and the state of our wilderness and the state of our national forest.
I've been biking through the woods here in the Swan Valley of Montana for the last few days. And what I've seen, you know, has been about half and half splendor and hellish waste.
We rode from beautiful old-growth forest stands, and the analogy, the comparison between the two areas is really very dramatic. The old-growth trees and the forests themselves are green, and they're alive, and they're wet, and they're cool, and they seem to represent everything that life is all about. The clear cuts, on the other hand, are hot, maybe 20 or 30 degrees warmer. They're dry, they're dusty, they're dead. They're a virtual desert. And they exist side by side because our Forest Service has allowed the lumber industry in this country to come in and make a quick profit by destroying vast, vast acres of what was once beautiful forest and wilderness.
And what's going on out there?
A press conference was held in Missoula, Montana, following the bike ride.
These lands in Montana, Oregon, and other states belong to all Americans, not just Americans today, but the generations that are yet unborn. They don't belong to any industry just to make a profit.
A couple months ago, I flew up to Vancouver, like I've been doing for about the past 20 years. And it struck me, I don't know why this particular trip, but it struck me how in the last 20 years that I've been flying up and back to the Northwest, how much of the forest has been destroyed, taken away. Now, the timber industry tells us that we have a timber shortage. If you fly over Washington and Oregon, it's no secret, we have a timber shortage.
The bike ride was only 200 miles, but it had repercussions that were felt as far as Washington, D.C.
When they clear cut down south and leave giant plantations, Georgia, Pacific, all through Tennessee, seems like the gold.
Save the Forest, another grassroots organization, held a rally on the steps of the Capitol.
When they clear cut in Maine, it's a major disaster. Diesel, Paul Bunyan's that blast through the tree. Strips by the road may disguise what they're after, but up in the air you can see what they leave.
Watch it, light on!
So climb up, you ladderback, see red or red cockade. Get furious, you flickers, to your belly headed. We'll curse the clear cutters, raise hell like a hellion. We're joining tonight.
Some of the bikers were present to offer their views.
I'd like to introduce now Bill Curry. He's with the Alliance for the Wild Rockies, and a significant achievement of his. Recently, he led the ride through the American forest with Bob Weir and John Oates, and that was very heavily covered. I think it's really important to recognize his achievement in bringing this issue to the forefront of the American conscience. And without further ado.
Thank you. About a year and a half ago, I moved to the state of Montana to a valley called the Bitterroot Valley. It's a beautiful place with lots of national forests, clean waters. It's got lots of wildlife, beautiful mountains. And I moved there to raise my son so he could be closer to the Mother Earth and learn about the important things of life. I bought my land near National Forest because I thought that it would always be protected. And I was shocked and outraged to find out that they were clear-cutting 386 acres behind my house. Old growth, wolf habitat, cutthroat trout habitat. I went to the mountain with the ranger, and I grew up thinking that the rangers were someone that were taking care of the forest and the animals. Smokey the Bear was our friend. Went on the mountain with him to the cut sites. There were 600-year-old ponderosa pine trees, and I asked him how much he was receiving for each tree. He told me $100. I said that I would buy every tree in the stand to protect this vital region. He laughed at me. They went ahead and cut the trees. They silted the water. There's a herd of elk that live there, 16 elk. All three herd bulls were killed in the clear cuts from the roads by hunters. Do what you can to help the Mother Earth. Ho.
It's what I would expect of anyone else, is what I try to do with my time. And I have a lot of good examples. I've met a lot of people in my lifetime who have been very committed to activism and have been very committed to expressing their opinions, you know. And when we have that as an option, which we do as Americans, why don't we take that chance more often? Why don't we, you know, extend ourselves into issues that affect us all and affect, you know, the future of the planet.
And back renews the oxygen.
In fact,
a forest is a habitat we depend on. Help us now.
Of course, not everyone is in agreement about the nature and effect of clear-cutting.
The theory that we have gone by is that harvesting trees is a legitimate use of public lands.
Okay.
And over the course of the years, they have conscientiously and consciously gone about developing a forest that is in fact a forest plantation, and it's a plantation in the same way that a farm is a farm. The problem with the forest industry is that our crop rotation is not 6 months; our crop rotation is 90 years.
We're still doing 19th century forestry in this country. And the precept of 19th century forestry was cut down all the virgin forests and create tree farms. Get it all under the management of man.
Well, as I've been researching this book that I'm doing on the Bitterroot, I came across this gem written in 1947. Clear cutting at the rate justified to reduce mortality losses as rapidly as practicable will result in high production for a few years and drastic curtailment later. Furthermore, such a procedure does not correct the imbalance in age classes. It merely shifts the unbalance from sawtimber stands to reproducing stands that will be inoperable for many years. From a Forest Service study, the Forest Service itself knew that in 1947.
So when you start talking about whether national forests should be harvesting a certain level of timber, there are people who would say that any given national forest may be harvesting too much timber, or maybe they shouldn't be harvesting in the manner they are harvesting. Maybe they shouldn't be clear cutting, they should be selection cutting. again, the response to that would be it depends upon the mix that you're trying to develop and the desired future that you're trying to establish on that national forest for the public.
One of the first meetings I was involved in, I had a Forest Service official say, "Well, Mr. Curry, you're not a forester." And I said, "All I have to do is walk into that clear cut and feel it in my stomach that it is wrong. It's against nature. It's against the animals that live there, the water itself that gives us the water that we drink daily. It affects the air we breathe."
The Forest Service did an inventory of the old growth that exists in the Bob Marsh Wilderness, which is right over the ridge over here. In the Bob Marsh Wilderness, there is no more, where there's never been any timber cut, there is no more than 12 to 17% old growth in any of the drainages. In this area, we don't have old growth as is defined, trees that are 150 years old. In this area, if we don't harvest the trees, they're either going to die, or they're going to get burned up, or they're going to fall over. Old growth simply doesn't exist. It's not a factor for us.
Don't get in the trap where you're arguing with the Forest Service or a timber company representative in their arena using their terminology.
Yeah.
You know, when they tell you that, you know, when they start talking about the advantages of clear-cutting an over-mature and decadent stand of forest, tell them that biologically there is no such thing. You know, you set the ground rules.
What happened here?
Yeah, you're on Forest Service. This is a what happened in terms of how it was set up?
Well, no, what happened to the trees?
No, they were cut and taken to the mill.
Yeah.
And now this is one thing I understand. I'm with Plum Creek, okay? And this is Forest Service unit, so I can't really tell you exactly what you're thinking here, okay? My company bought the timber that was cut here, and so we hired the logger that took it off.
How come you didn't leave any trees at all?
On this particular site, what's happened here is everything's been slashed down, and I think the Forest Service plans to broadcast burn it to prepare a seedbed for the new crop.
Did you say crop?
Yeah, a viable crop.
You look at trees as corn? As corn?
No. Corn is corn, trees are trees.
Yeah. A forest is a forest. What happens to the animals that used to live here? Where are they now? There's no habitat for them.
Well, there's the habitat's not gone, the habitat's just changed.
To what, desert?
No, I'd say it's going through a transition. Nature does that herself, whether through insects, disease, forest fire, that sort of thing.
I've never seen anything nature does that looks like this, ever. Unless it's just, I've never seen, even a burn, I've never seen anything look so scarred and ugly and devastated.
Well, that's fair, that's a sensitivity judgment.
There's more concern now than there was 15 years ago about clear cutting. And so we look harder at alternatives to clear cutting, even though we believe that in many cases, clear cutting best replicates natural systems. But they're not very pretty. They're ugly.
Clear cutting does, to a large degree, simulate nature. It doesn't do it perfectly.
Clear cutting does not emulate any natural process whatsoever.
In a natural setting, where a fire goes through an area, for instance, and quote, clear cuts the area, there is fire that's left on the ground from those trees that contributes to the nutrients in the ground. Okay. In a clear cut, we take that fiber and make lumber and jobs out of it. But the trade-off is that in a fire situation, even though there's nutrients left, there's also carbon that's put up in the air, which contributes to global warming. We don't contribute to global warming. We clear cut the area, and we contribute to regeneration of the forest.
You see that most of the trees that die in a natural burn remain in the system. They stand for 30, 50, sometimes up to 75 years, providing nesting habitat for woodpeckers and other cavity nesting birds and mammals. They shade the forest floor, which is very important in the late summer in the Northern Rockies. When they fall to the forest floor, they hold the soil in place and prevent erosion. They slowly decompose. Underneath the logs is habitat for small rodents that spread the spores of mycorrhizal fungi, which help the regenerating forest grow. In short, we are being fed myths. I guess I'm being polite using the word myth.
We're being fed lies by the timber industry.
There's this over here.
Sick.
They say that the reason for clear cutting, they say, is it simulates a natural disaster, a forest fire. So here's what happens. After a few years, when they've actually done that. Now, right over here, this hillside was a forest fire. See, things are growing on that hillside. It's going to come back. Over here, you can see, back over here, you can see on the top, the vegetation is going away. In another couple of years, the topsoil will be entirely gone. Nothing will ever grow there again. And you can't tell the people who engineer this kind of mayhem, you can't tell them that this is wrong. They won't hear it. It's heartbreaking. It's also infuriating.
Certain species require full sunlight and access to the full use of the site. And that's because they evolved over the centuries where the main disturbing factor was fire. And a whole group of plant and animal species evolved to take advantage of that situation. And these species can only be maintained, or certainly best be maintained, by use of practice that simulates fire, but without the uncontrolled and other negative aspects of fire, which include smoke and property damage and whatever. So basically, the tree species like aspen, which in this picture are the yellow trees, can be maintained and are maintained by practices that produce openings in the forest canopy.
But the fact is that we have more than enough open space and not enough protected forest in this country. So that the species that are for a short time promoted by clear cutting are not the species that are threatened or endangered or rare. The species that are threatened are the ones that are harmed by clear cutting.
The national forests provide more outdoor recreation than any other entity, organization, or land base in the United States, certainly, and although we don't have the statistics, probably in the free world and perhaps in the whole world. Certainly there are cases where timber harvesting is done specifically to enhance other resources.
So when people say, well, we ought to stop all of this, what they're saying, or what they fail to realize, is that a lot of that is contributing to people's recreational enjoyment. The number one use on the national forest today is driving for pleasure.
When we went out on the forest, we saw that the Forest Service didn't have maps of their roads. They don't know how many roads they have.
The Forest Service says that clear cuts and logging roads are important for recreation. But in fact, the real demand in this country that's not being satisfied is not for roaded recreation on the national forests. It's for primitive recreation. We have more than enough roads to satisfy the demand for another 20 years. What we don't have is wilderness and pristine areas and trails.
And we're learning, I think, on a deeper level, that the purpose of wilderness isn't simply to have places to backpack in, have places to ride horses in, or to have places to hunt and fish in. Those are all important and valid uses of designated wilderness. But we're learning that the real reason that we need to save our remaining wildlands and our remaining native forests, and I mean all of them, is because the survival of life on Earth depends on it.
We have a hard time competing with the emotional appeal that the environmental movement has. When they start talking about the woodpeckers and the owls and the grizzly bear, that's a very, very appealing issue. You know, oh my God, we're destroying the grizzly bear habitat. That's a very emotional issue, a very emotional appeal. We have a hard time competing with that. We don't believe that we're destroying the grizzly bear habitat by cutting timber.
People don't like to live, nor do they like to do business, nor do they like to work amidst environmental destruction. People want and are willing to make considerable sacrifices to gain access to the types of high quality environments that wilderness protection provides us with. In that sense, those wilderness lands are a crucial, an extremely crucial part of Western Montana and the Northern Rockies economic base,
and need very badly the protection that these groups are trying to provide it.
When we go to the bank and we want to invest in new equipment and we go to the bank needs to have some assurance that we're going to be here 3 years from now in order to pay off that loan. Typically, we carried a large inventory of logs under contract so that we had that assurance. Today, we don't have that anymore. That's been the major impact on our company of the environmental movement thus far, the modern environmental movement.
The wood products industry is going to be nothing but an ongoing downward pressure, and that has nothing to do with wilderness protection or reforming the Forest Service. It has to do with the fact that the major outside players in the game, Champion International, Plum Creek, and the other industrial forest landowners, have been chopping away at the trees at 2, 3, 4, 5 times sustainable yield.
The primary factor in reducing timber jobs in Montana and Idaho in the last 10 years, and the only factor in the next 10 years, is going to be the reduction in timber supply in those states, the amount that the mills can cut, that will occur has occurred by virtue of the fact that the forest won't yield as much because they've been overcut. Environmental constraints and wilderness protection aren't contributing more than 1 or 2%.
I think that the timber, the people who depend on timber and wood products for a living are not going to gain the sympathy of the general public until it starts hitting the general public in the pocketbook. The fact of the matter is, we would not be cutting timber in Montana if they weren't building frame houses back in Vermont. And when those frame houses in Vermont start to cost, $150,000 rather than $100,000, and the reason is because they have to import lumber from Russia or lumber from Australia because we can't make lumber in this country anymore, then those people are going to realize that, wait a minute, there's a problem here, and it's affecting me. And no matter how appealing the grizzly bear is as an issue, when it starts hitting them in the pocketbook, I think it's going to be something they're going to look at the situation a little more carefully.
You think there's going to be a shortage in supply around here, say a 30 or 40 year gap before the second crop comes on?
I have some feelings on that. That's a tough one to answer because, like I say, that's probably a corporate spokesman would be better.
But do you have personal
able
feelings?
To handle that? Well, what I can tell you is that all our lands are managed to grow trees. That's what we are. We're a tree growing company. In terms of the rate things are being cut or the rationale, there's a lot of forces I don't understand, and they do involve the marketplace and Wall Street and
corporate takeovers.
yeah, things like that. And there's a lot of things I'm not privy to. And
In 1976, Congress passed the National Forest Management Act. And the National Forest Management Act lays out a process for us to use to develop national forest plans, national forest land and resource management plans. And those plans are once completed, they're intact basically for 10 to 15 years before they're revised.
The national parks, however, are facing resource and management problems because of a myriad of natural and man-made threats. Yet there is little public or private funding available to address those problems.
Yeah, thanks, John.
The Alliance for the Wild Rockies decided to take the battle out of the forest and into the halls of Congress. The Alliance has proposed the Wild Rockies National Lands Act. The bill covers forest land in 5 states: Montana, Idaho, Wyoming, Oregon, and Washington.
We're looking at a multi-state federal wildlands bill that's a departure from the traditional process of going state by state.
The bill that has been proposed by the Alliance for Wild Rockies is a good bill. It's an excellent approach to take a bioregional view of an area and take care of it.
I want to say that in terms of the Forest Service and how they're handling the destruction of our forests, consider this. Let's say for every $100 spent on building roads into areas that they then clear cut, the income generated by the Forest Service is on that timber sale is $10. That $90 difference is a loss. If you were running a business at that kind of loss, you would go out of business. The Forest Service is not going out of business, and the reason is because the American taxpayer is paying the difference. The Wild Rockies National Lands Act that is being proposed here today is a bill that we hope addresses that problem. It would eliminate any further road building in the roadless areas. It would protect the wilderness. It's a triple win situation. The bill proposes a wildland restoration and recovery system. Under the system, four areas would be designated as part of a pilot program. These areas, which have been damaged by unwise development and resource extraction practices, will now be managed to restore their native vegetative cover and species diversity. Unneeded roads will be closed. Native fish spawning runs will be reestablished. In general, the lands will be restored to their natural condition. In doing so, new jobs in the community will be created. What are the chances of the bill being passed? What are the chances of any bill proposed by a grassroots organization of being passed? Only time will tell. But is there enough time? And how serious is this issue?
Everyone has to start doing something. We just haven't got much time left to start turning things around. Lester Brown of the World Watch Institute back east has said that we have about 10 years to get our society on a sustainable basis. And if we don't do that within the next 10 or 12 years, we'll start into a more an increasing spiral of environmental and economic degradation that will be really nearly impossible to pull out of.
People like Dr. Michael Soule, who founded the Society for Conservation Biology, are now saying that our biggest nature reserves, our biggest wilderness areas and national parks are too small to allow for the continuing evolution of large vertebrate animals. And if you think about that, that in our lifetimes, we have literally cut off the evolutionary process in our brother species, sister species, that's something that I can't even fathom.
Evolution of large vertebrate animals will be impaired if not ended. How much longer can we human beings deny that we're just a part, a strand in this web of life? Right on.
In a few million years, who knows if we will be around? In a few thousand, in a few years period, will humans still be around?
But by riding through a beautiful forest and then riding into a desert that looked like the day after, the day after.
You know, it's one thing to be sitting in your home watching TV and watching this on TV in your school or sitting in your living room and say, well, another few trees won't really matter, but another few trees will matter.
That it's way, way past time, not the time.
So time a little letter that seems too intoxicated. Get curious, you flickers, P-O-T-L-E-A-D-E-S. We'll curse the clear cutters, or raise hell like the hellions. Joining tonight the woodpecker rebellions. Think you can all get that chorus down?
If the environmentalists are right, and we do not have much time left, then the apocalypse may already be upon us. This may indeed be evolution's end. And hail and fire followed, mingled with blood, and they were thrown to the earth. And a third of the trees were burned up, and all green grass was burned up. Revelations.
The rivers flow for everyone. Through your own backyard, down to the ocean they run. They start out small, they're big before they're done. And if you better yourself, you better everyone. The rivers flow for everyone. Through your own backyard, down to the ocean they run. They start as small, they're big before they're done. And take one step, the hard part's done. A big cool place. It started out blue, it's getting blacker every day. The rivers flow from everyone, from your own backyard down to the ocean they run, to the ocean they run. The ocean they run.